Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one, I call Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Government what discussions the Culture Secretary has had with the Music Venues Trust regarding the introduction of a ticket levy, whether on a voluntary or statutory basis, for stadium and arena shows to support grassroots culture venues?
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Patrick Harvey for his question. The Scottish Government fully values the importance of the music industry to Scotland's culture and the role venues play in the talent pipeline. I met with the Music Venue Trust in May to discuss the difficulties faced by the industry at a grassroots level and the proposal for a ticket levy to alleviate these and help build a sustainable live music ecosystem. The Scottish Government is keen to continue to engage with the industry to support sector-led initiatives.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm pleased that the Cabinet Secretary has met with the Music Venues Trust. I'm not quite clear if he's expressed a view on the basic policy yet, but this summer, as he'll know, we've seen huge stadium performances in Scotland from the likes of Taylor Swift, Foo Fighters and Pink. And the Music Venues Trust show the introduction of a levy, which has already been done in countries like France, for example, could raise well over £1 million a year to support the sector during a very, very difficult time. And the Cabinet Secretary, I'm sure, is well aware of the cultural importance of independent venues, which aren't necessarily charitable. Some of them are commercial.
Question, please, Mr.
Some Harvey. Of them are funded, some of them are not. This would be a really powerful measure of supporting those venues that are integral to the culture
Mr.
of our
Harvey.
Towns and cities.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I agree with Patrick Harvey about the importance to agree to support venues. This was an issue that I raised with my Culture Secretary opposite number in the last UK government, and it is one that I will raise with Lisa Nandy of the new incoming UK government. I think Patrick Harvey will appreciate that this proposal involves significant reserved powers. These are things that I'm keen to better understand about their deliverability, and it is part of a dialogue that I look forward to continuing to have with the Department of Culture, Media, Sport and the UK Government.
Supplementary, George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Despite the financial implications of the new Labour government's financial decisions, it's welcome that the SNP Scottish Government is still increasing funding to the culture sector by almost £16 million in this financial year to £196.6 million. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline how this funding ensures support for culture venues throughout Scotland and obviously the money being sent out by Creative Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the additional £15.8 million in culture funding this financial year is the first stage in our commitment to £100 million more per year for culture funding by 2028-2029. And the additional funding this financial year includes £13.2 million for Creative Scotland, and this has been used to support their network of regularly funded organisations, including the Scottish Music Industry Association, as well as providing additional funding towards the Creative Scotland Open Fund for individuals and additional support to Screen Scotland.
Question number two, James Dornan.
To ask the Scottish Government how its investment in Fairer Futures partnerships will help to tackle child poverty.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley Ann Somerville.
So our investment in expanding our Fairer Futures partnership, we will work with local authorities to help families get the support that matters to them, focusing on family wellbeing, income maximisation and support towards education and sustained employment. This includes a range of services working together across childcare, education, health and social care, housing and employment, the third sector and beyond. This work will develop practical examples and tools to support more effective service delivery that can be used to tackle child poverty across Scotland.
James Dornan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. Before I go on to a supplementary, with the indulgence of the Chamber, if you wouldn't mind me just mentioning the passing of Councillor Kenny McLean, who was a councillor when I was the leader of Glasgow City Council, who was a hard worker for his constituents in his ward in Partick East. He was tireless in working for Glasgow, and he was a huge supporter of making Scotland a better place through independence. But more importantly, he was a great man. He will be sadly missed by his family and everybody who knew him. Uh, Thank you. With devolved finances tighter than ever as a result of the UK Government's decision, how does the Cabinet Secretary anticipate Fairer Futures Partnerships will help to laser focus Scotland's constrained resources and public services on the mission to eradicate child poverty?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. And can I begin by associating myself with remarks James Dornan made around Councillor Maclean? He and I were parliamentary researchers in the first intake in 1999, and I remember him fondly, and his words of wisdom will be greatly missed by myself and others. But in relation to the question that, despite facing the most challenging financial circumstances since devolution, we are determined to drive forward the national mission to end child poverty, and that investment in our Fairer Futures Partnership will provide a driver to enable local authorities to test and improve how they deliver services and thus better supporting families. That development of practical examples and tools can therefore be shared much more widely than even just with the partnership organisations that we're taking part in. I think it's a very important part of our public service reform programme.
Question number three, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it's taking to improve access to GP appointments.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last November, the Scottish Government published the General Practice Access Principles. This report sets out a clear framework for the core principles of how GP services should be delivered equitably, sensitively, reasonably, and appropriately, making the most effective use of resources and systems currently available. We continue to work together with all relevant partners to effectively implement these principles, including through our commitment to the ongoing recruitment of primary care multidisciplinary teams, as well as 800 more GPs. Healthcare Improvement Scotland has already worked with over 100 general practices to improve access arrangements.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but the current situation remains a disgrace. And the increased move to same-day-only appointments rationed at 8 a.m. simply doesn't work for the elderly, disabled or those with young children. The latest in the long line of complaints I've had from a constituent includes an elderly couple in Dumfries, and they'll probably give me a clip round the ear for saying that next time I see them, who tried on 4 occasions to get a doctor's appointment. Day one, a permanent engaged tone at appointment time, unable to speak to a human voice. Yep. Day two, same again, permanent engaged tone. Day three, 10 minutes in a queue to get to the front, human voice, but no doctors available. Only on the fourth day, when they then decided to complain to the practice, did they get an appointment. Does the Cabinet Secretary think that's acceptable?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Oliver Mundell for that question. What he narrates is clearly not acceptable, and I would believe that we should see access to GPs improving. I think we are seeing an increase of demand upon our primary care services, and GPs are managing more complex cases and are so under pressure as a result. But obviously it's the responsibility of individual practices to ensure that they have an appointment system that works not just for them but for their patients, most importantly. So I'd be keen to hear more about Oliver Mundell's case so that can be brought up and indeed looked into by the Health Board as to whether or not they're fulfilling the merits of the GP contract.
Brief supplementary, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government General Practice Access Principles state GP practices should use digital resources where appropriate and when people choose to meet their needs. Deaf people or those with anxiety may find it more difficult to book appointments over the phone, and services such as Near Me are not available everywhere. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise if the Scottish Government has further plans to support GPs in adopting digital infrastructure where they are not able to provide these services?
Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Faisal Chowdhury for narrating what is a complex picture in terms of how people choose to access their health services, in this case primary care services. And he's right that there are digital solutions available for some people who are able to use that, but I'm very clear that that won't work for everybody, as Faisal Chowdhury has set out. So we are supporting, and I would want to see more support for practices to be able to invest in not just the access requirements that I've set out to Oliver Mundell, but also the digital services where that's possible, and we'll be continue to support boards to do just that.
Question number four, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to concerns over its reported plans to downgrade the neonatal intensive care unit at Ninewells Hospital.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Under the new model of neonatal care announced in July 2023, neonatal intensive care will be provided in a smaller number of units with co-located specialist services. This model is based on evidence and clinical advice from neonatal experts, which shows that the most preterm and sickest babies have a better chance of survival when they are cared for in high-volume specialist neonatal units. These specialist intensive care units will be in the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital, Edinburgh Royal Infirmary and Aberdeen Maternity Hospital. Local neonatal units will continue to deliver care to babies who need it, including a level of intensive care, and these changes will only affect a small number of the smallest and sickest babies.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but there was little, if any, mention in the report of the potential impact on the mental well-being of families forced to travel far from their home during what is already a harrowing time for them. It's unacceptable. So does the Minister agree there should be a fuller assessment before taking any action?
Minister.
I thank Maurice Golden for his question and absolutely recognise the traumatic time it must be for new parents in these circumstances. This model of neonatal care is supported by a range of stakeholders and clinicians, and we have consulted through Bliss and also with a wider cohort of families as well. This work is ongoing. We have had a number of reports a report that is now being led by the regional clinical leads at looking at the implementation, and of course the mental health and support of families is very much at the centre of the work.
Brief supplementary, Willie Rennie.
This doesn't just affect my constituents who use Ninewells, but also Victoria and Kirkcaldy. I would want the best care. I would want to be able to access the best care for my family. But my concern is that ever greater specialism leads to ever greater centralisation, leads to de-skilling in regional facilities. So how does the Minister make the judgment about when specialism is enough, when centralisation is enough, and that we need to hold up the skills within the regional centres so that everybody can get access to the best care in their local facility?
Minister.
I thank Willie Rennie for his question, and this is exactly what drives this decision-making, which was led by experts within the neonatal sphere of health services and also building on international evidence as well. It's incredibly important. The key thing is to ensure the safety, the health of the smallest and sickest babies, and that has been what has been absolutely central to all the work and all the evidence that's been pulled together.
Question number 5, Lorna Slater.
To ask the Scottish Government, in light of the recently published Holyrood Park Strategy Plan, what the timeline is for Historic Environment Scotland to complete its movement strategy and deliver on its 10 objectives for the park?
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
I thank Lorna Slater for her question. Questions regarding day-to-day operational matters of Historic Environment Scotland, including queries relating to the management of Holyrood Park, are best answered directly by Historic Environment Scotland, and I'll ask Hez to respond directly to the member with a full reply to her question in writing.
Lorna Slater.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Holyrood Park's legislation is decades out of date, and it doesn't align with the Council or Government's climate targets or the City of Edinburgh's mobility plan. Will the Cabinet Secretary look at updating the park's legislation and consider reducing or restricting private car use in Holyrood Park in order to ensure the park is net zero by 2030, as the new strategic plan sets out?
Cabinet Secretary.
I met yesterday with the new Chief Executive of Historic Environment Scotland, Katharina Brown. I'm pleased that we have a shared ambition for Historic Environment Scotland. I'm sure that she and colleagues will have been listening very closely to what Lorna Slater has asked, and I will be raising the issues that she has raised with me, with officials, and I will revert to her in writing, given the supplementary question that she posed to me.
Question number 6 has been withdrawn. Question number 7, Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will review its relationship with LGBT Youth Scotland in light of reported allegations regarding safeguarding failings.
Minister Cocab Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would also like to mark the passing of Councillor McLean, who was the Councillor within my constituency of Glasgow Kelvin and a friend. With regards to the question, I thank Megan Gallagher for her question. The Scottish Government have engaged with LGBT Youth Scotland to determine the facts around the recent media reports, and we have determined that no further action is needed at this stage. I refer the member to LGBT Youth Scotland's recent statement that reinforces how they have strengthened their safeguarding policies over the last 5 years to ensure they are in line with legislation and also meet national standards. The organisation continues to review their safeguarding policies annually to ensure they are as comprehensive as possible.
Megan Gallagher.
Children in Need, who awarded LGBT Youth Scotland £181,000 over the last 5 years, have decided to withdraw their funding. The BBC said its charity had immediately suspended the grant after conducting a thorough review in response to concerns that's been raised by the BBC and others. This comes after the Mail published a damning investigation of LGBT Youth Scotland, where former chief executive James Rennie was jailed for horrific child sex assaults after he was unmasked as a member of one of Britain's worst ever paedophile rings. I've raised concerns about LGBT Youth Scotland in this very chamber, the guidance they provide to and the guidance that they provide to children and young people regarding safeguarding. Yet another scandal has now emerged that convicted paedophile Andrew Easton co-authored a guidance with LGBT Youth Scotland on coming out as transgender for children as young as 13. So if there's no further case to be answered, Minister, why have these safeguarding failings taken place in the first place? Why has Children in Need removed their funding? And why is the Scottish Government not agreeing to conducting, at the very least, a review into LGBT Youth Scotland regarding what's happened in recent times?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Member has raised several points which I am not able to answer in such a short time. However, I would be happy to put further comments in writing. However, we are committed to advancing equality and supporting LGBTQI and young people, including through funding of LGBT Youth Scotland. This is particularly important at a time when we are seeing a rise in attacks against the LGBTQI community. I would also like to point out that LGBT Youth Scotland are not under any criminal investigation. Recent media reports related to a convicted individual who was a young person when he attended the charity in 2009, but was not a volunteer or a paid employee.
Thank you. Brief supplementary, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is so important that children and young people have somewhere that they can go to expect care, safety and advice, even if, sadly, that is not at home. What is the Scottish Government doing to support LGBTQ young people and ensure that they grow up feeling supported?
Minister.
I thank Emma Roddick for that answer and for the opportunity to reaffirm our commitment to doing everything we can to make sure that Scotland is the best place to grow up for LGBTQI plus young people. This is particularly important, as I said, as we are seeing a rise in attacks against that community. We are providing £290,870 worth of funding to LGBT Youth Scotland for 2024-25 through our Equality and Human Rights Fund to deliver a range of projects to support LGBTQI plus young people. We've also made significant progress in embedding LGBTQI plus inclusive education across the curriculum rather than in specific LGBTQI plus lessons to improve the learning environment for all children and young people.
Thank you. Question number 8, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the implementation of the recommendations from the National Review of Eating Disorder Services.
Minister Marie Todd.
The Scottish Government is committed to implementing the recommendations of the National Review of Eating Disorder Services. We've established the National Eating Disorder Network, which is supporting us to deliver on the medium and long-term recommendations. Additionally, we've established an Eating Disorder Lived Experience Panel to support the work of the network. The National Specification for Care and Treatment of Eating Disorders in Scotland, which outlines the national standards of service that anyone impacted by eating disorders can expect from services, will be published this year.
Evan Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for that answer. Could the Minister please outline what action the National Eating Disorder Network is taking to improve training, national level service development, setting quality standards and coordinating research and innovation networks for eating disorders?
Minister.
The National Eating Disorder Network is working with NHS Education Scotland to ensure accessibility of training for all and to raise awareness of available training. The network has scheduled regional meetings for clinicians to discuss challenges, share successes, highlight improvement activity and explore opportunities to work regionally to improve consistency of access. A series of webinars offered by the network will focus on research and innovation in Scotland and the UK, offering insights on practical implementation, whilst the network will also consider how to tackle gaps in research. Finally, the network will work closely with boards to support implementation of the national specification.